Okay, are there any questions before I start?
Professor, you didn't post the midterm papers?
A long time back, I did post maybe
one.
Yes, did you see the one I posted?
Yeah.
Yes. Sorry?
I didn't get time to go through, but I saw that it's posted.
Yeah, so yes, so there is one sample midterm from last time, so there are a couple of problems I suggested to review, but I didn't post any more because the other sample exams have problems unfolding and unfolding, so you should review them. I also have taken a number of old exams and have given them to you as homework, so there isn't really many more sample exams to hand out. But do review the ones that there are. I mean, the three sample exams that were posted early on, please review the problems related to unfolding and folding. And the sample exam that I posted from last time, there is at least one problem on systolic and another problem on some data format converters. So review those. Okay, today my goal today is to complete the chapter 13 on computer arithmetic and binary arithmetic. And last class, I began talking about bit serial multipliers. We didn't get very far, but I started talking about how to design bit serial multipliers. So, okay. So we talked about the fact that bit serial multipliers process one bit at a time and compute one output bit at a time. So so the first step is to use the so-called Horner's rule and express the product x is equal to a times b. Well, I should probably write capital B, that doesn't matter. Okay, so x is equal to A times B, which is written like that. Okay, so now we can write this as a block diagram. So, I guess what I was talking about last time is what are these quantities called 2 to power minus 1 mean? Okay, so we did have the block diagram, we'll talk more about that. So 2 to power minus 1 is a so-called scalar, divide by 2, and divide by 2 means shift the number one bit to the right, and that means if I'm going to maintain the same word length throughout the design, that means throw out the LSB because that's shifted and gone out of the system, and then sine extend by one bit. Okay, that's what 2 to power minus 1 does. So 2 to power minus 1 by itself is a non-causal operation. And that's because I gave you an example here. If we feed A0 through A7, starting with the clock cycle 0, 1, 2, etc., then the output, desired output A1, should be available in clock cycle 0. We have thrown out the LSB. We want the output A1 through A7, sine extended by 1 bit, and that means this should be available ideally in clock cycle 0. But A1 is not input to the system until clock cycle 1, and that's why it's a non-causal system. And to make it causal and implementable, we introduce a latency of one clock cycle. So although the 2 to power minus 1 itself is non-implementable, because that's not causal, appended with a delay element, so the combination of the 2 to power minus 1 scalar and the delay element together makes it causal, and I can implement that using the small circuit here, which shows that the 2 to power minus 1 combined with a delay can be implemented as a switch where we connect the input to the to these cycles. So for example, if its word length is 8, so the switch connects here 8L plus 0 through 8L plus 7. In cycle 8L, when it's a multiple of 8, we connect the switch here. And in that cycle, I am reading from the output of the delay what was fed into in clock cycle 7. If the word length is 8, what is available at the output of the delay at clock cycle 8 is what was input at clock cycle 7, and that's nothing but A7. So that A7 is available here, and in clock cycle 8, if the word length is 8, that would be a new A0, and that new A0 is ignored because this is connected here, and then we take A1, so then we get the next A1. Okay, so that's basically so-called a scalar. So let's spend a little more time on now we know what 2 to power minus 1 scalar is. So how do I take this the high level diagram that I had shown and put that into a bit serial multiplier? So it says here A is input bit by bit. Now A times B0, so that's generating partial product bits A times B0, so A comes in, A0, A1, A2, etc. And then that 2 to power minus 1 is really not implementable, okay, because I already explained to you that in order to be able to implement the 2 to power minus 1, we need to append a delay, and that becomes implementable. So, but how do I get a delay? Well, I don't have a delay here. Now, it so happens, well, indeed, there is no delay, but I can create a delay by using pipelining cut sets like that. So, once I place pipelining cut sets at these locations, then let me just take a look. It seems like I missed something here. The very last part, there should be another 2 to power minus 1 scalar, which means there should be another pipelining cut set here. Okay. All right. So by introducing these pipelining cut sets, we of course have delay elements on this line, and you can multiplication is a lot like convolution or filtering. So in some sense, what was looking like a data broadcast no longer broadcast because we've introduced these delays. Okay. So 2 to power minus 1 combined with the delay element here indeed can be implemented by a switch that we have seen before. So that's 2 to power minus 1. So then I need to add to that A times B1. So so I have A times B1, that fits here. By the way, do not forget that delay, pipeline delay between these two. Okay, so now, let me see if I have a table here. Okay, I have a table here. Recall when I showed this, this is from both recording, but doesn't matter. So when I take 2 to power minus 1 times B0, we have thrown this out and we, so the first add operation begins in log cycle 1. And that's consistent with what I said, which is throw this A0 out, then add A times B1 so that it lines below A1. Okay, so we had seen that before. So which means, so in clock cycle 1, I reset the carry input to the bit, one bit adder, binary adder. Okay, I'm not writing down the other switch instances, but 1 means that's really all other 7 outputs. If I put a number like 7 by 8, or you will recognize that this is everything else except 8L plus 1. And here, as we said, the in clock cycle 8, we repeat the previous input so that we sign extend. So so the first add operation, this add operation, A times B0 times 2 to power minus 1 plus A times B1 continues from clock cycle 1 up to 8. Clock cycle 9 to 16 will be the next add operation, next A, whatever the word length of A is, okay. Well, I've assumed A word length to be 8. Okay, so that's the first adder. So the next one, so A times B1, so we have completed that add, that follows by 2 to the power minus 1 and a delay. So now that 2 to the power minus 1 and a delay has another switch like that. And there is a delay here, which is the pipeline delay, and there is A times B2, and that all goes to the binary adder, and then we reset the carry here in clock cycle. From when do you think this add can begin? In clock cycle 1, I get the first result, okay? Clock cycle 1, but because of the 2 to the power minus 1, I need to throw that away. So that means the first add with A times B2 can begin in 8L plus 2. And that's when the carry is cleared to 0. Otherwise, I feed this a bit serial multiplier. I should say this is a bit serial multiplier. Okay, there is... There was a lot of interest in these kinds of multipliers, bit serial multipliers in 60s and late 60s, 70s, because parts were available only in discrete parts. There was no, not even SSI, small scale integration. Okay. I should say that there is probably very less interest in these kinds of designs today. Okay, so then we basically continue with that. So I guess I could skip a few things. So let's see if I can have enough space here. B3, B4, B5, B6. B7. Okay, I am going to skip. It all looks like that. So it all same thing. Okay, so dot, dot, dot. So what's going on in the last thing? So the last, very last step is to subtract, is not to add. We need to compute that minus A times B7, which says that if B7 is 0, don't do anything. If B7 is 1, then subtract A. So the way we implement that is if B7 is 1, then we invert this this inversion. This inversion is a NOT gate, okay? That's a NOT operation. And then that goes to the last binary adder. Something comes from that, and then we reset the carry to 1. not zero, because when we are subtracting, the carry is reset one. So this is, if B7 is 1, we get A bar and 1 in the LSB, and that subtracts. If B7 is 0, okay, this should be 0, so that's why instead of calling it 1, we call that B7. So if I call this carry input B7, which is the same B7 here, then if B7 is 0, carry input is 0. If B7 is 1, carry input is 1, and the input A is complemented, once complemented or inverted. Okay, so together this once complement here and the carry input B7 take care of the subtraction part, which is the 2's complement. Is that making sense? Okay. I guess you are not doing homework, but that's perfectly fine. I mean, if there is a need to learn, you can learn these things. The reason I want to talk about it is because I think it does show us a number of things in design. So then that's the final product, X. Okay, so by the way, this should be cleared, as you can see here. So first adder 1, second adder 2, so this would be 8L plus 7. And that means the first result will come out in 8L plus 7. Okay, first result will come out in 8L plus 7. Okay, that's good. I want to tell you that this whole multiplier is a non-pipelined multiplier. While it is true that I have made these scalars, non-causal scalars, implementable by making them causal, there is no real delay. So these 2 to power minus 1 and that delay make it causal, but this critical path from adder to adder to continues. There is no delay. So if I were to, let's say that I am interested in designing a bit level pipelined bit serial multiplier. So this is not bit level pipelined. If the word length is 8, the critical path is one of these AND gate and then 7 binary adders. That's the critical path. Now, if I want to make this bit level pipelined, what is the process of pipelining this? Any thoughts? Well, I mean, it's as simple as just place one more pipelining cut set. If I want another additional delay, then just place another pipelining cut set after every add, then that will create one more delay. So if we place another pipelining cut set, that will make one delay here, one delay here. So that delay becomes 2 delays, one delay here, one delay here, and so on. So all these one delays on the top will now become 2 delays, and there will be an adder here. What other change do I need to make? I need to change these, so this 2 becomes a 3. Now by this time, there are 2 extra delays. If this was 8L plus 3, for the next stage, that will become a 4. Okay, so 3 will become a 5. And then what about 7? 7 will become what? I have increased the number of delays by how many? 6, right? So this one doesn't count. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this 7 becomes 7 plus 16, 6, 13. Which is equivalent to 8L plus 5. So those are the changes that we need to make to the design so that the bit serial multiplier is pipelined at 1 bit level. Well, if I wanted it to be pipelined at 2 bit levels, then introduce cut sets at alternate places. Is that making sense? Well, surely there are no new concepts. We have talked about all these before. This is called a bit serial programmable multiplier because these B0, B1, B2, etc. can be any number, so this is a programmable multiplier. In digital filters, especially fixed point digital filters, a lot of the digital filters are constant coefficient filters. This is a programmable multiplier. I should say this. This is also when I was doing my PhD and I was reviewing all these things. That's long, long ago. This is really by Dick Lyon, Lyon's Multiplier. And well, he published this paper called Bacterial Multiplier. I don't know. I mean, maybe 70s, some 70s. Let's see if there is a reference to Dick's paper. 1970 something, I would assume. But we can take a look and see. Yeah, that's reference 14 in the chapter, 1976. So if you want to read, well, now that I've taught it, it should be easy to understand. So that's Dick's paper, Dick Lyon, is April 76. Okay, so I should say that this is, although Lyon's Multiplier is well understood, Dick is really famous for a number of things, many, many things. Well, he did a lot of interesting work on cochlear implants with carbamide at Caltech, then spent many years at Apple, and has spent many years at Google, where he is now currently. So, okay, any question about bit serial multiplier, programmable bit serial? So let's talk about fixed coefficients. So a lot of the digital filters have constant coefficients. So if I want to implement a constant coefficient bit serial multiplier, let me take an example from the book so that way I can show the details, detailed circuits. Even though I don't draw all the details, I can just show you where they are. Let's take let's take 1329. Okay, well, yeah, that should be, this is example 13.5.1. Okay, this, it so happens to be a second order IIR digital filter, and that has a transfer function of 1 over 1 plus 7 by 32 z to the power minus 1 minus 3 by 4 z to the power minus 2. Okay, so bring these two terms to the left side, and you can see xz by uz is that quantity. Okay, so so let's not worry about the fact that it is IIR, but let's start with how do I multiply. So let's start with minus 7 over 32. So I want to compute minus 7 over 32 times something, times x n minus 1, but it doesn't really matter. Well, minus 7 by 32 times well, let's just call x for now, it doesn't really matter. So I can write minus 7 over 32 in 2's complement as minus 16 plus 9. So this is minus 16 plus 9, which can then be written as 8 plus 1. So that's minus 16 over 32 plus 8 over 32 plus 1 over 32 times x. If I apply Horner's rule, that will be minus half, minus 2 to the power minus 1, plus 1 by 4, which is 2 to the power minus 2 plus 1 by 32, which is 2 to the power minus 5 times x. Now we are going to apply Horner's rule. So if I take 2 to the power minus 2 outside the bracket, this is 1 plus 2 to the power minus 3. And then out of these two, if I take 2 to the power minus 1 outside a bracket, then we have minus 1 plus 2 to the power minus 1 times x. Okay, that's brought the Horner expansion of the quantity minus 7 by 32x. Okay. Okay, so how do we implement this? I can draw a block diagram. So if this is x, so I can write that as x. This is x. First, I add x plus 1 plus 2 to the power minus 3 times x. That's x plus 2 to the power minus 3x. Okay, that's that quantity. Followed by a scalar 2 to the power minus 1. And then I subtract. So then I subtract x, followed by another scalar. That's the result. Okay, so that's the product. So 1 plus 2 to the power minus 3 times 2 to the power minus 1 minus 1 times 2 to the power minus 1, that's minus 7 over 32. How do we take that block diagram and use that, convert that to a circuit? First of all, in order to make this causal, I need at least 3 pipelining cut sets here, because that's 2 to the power minus 3. Remove 3 LSBs and sine extend 3 times. That's what that does. In order to remove that, I need that one, and I need to have one pipelining cut set here so that this is implementable now. That's implementable, and these are implementable. These are still non-pipelined, but these are implementable for sure. Okay, so I take. So we are just trying to see how to implement x times minus 7 over 32. So that's x. And then that 2 to the power minus 3, if you generalize the concept, we have 3 delays instead of 1 delay that I had here. We have 3 delays. And that's that 3 delay, and the input can be reset to 0 in what clock cycle? It can begin only in clock cycle 8L plus 3, right? Do you understand why the addition can begin? Because the input came clock cycle 0, 1, 2, those bits are thrown out. We don't do anything with that. The first operation begins in clock cycle 3, so 8L plus 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 3 to 7 are the switch is connecting here. And then I sine extend once. So this is 8L, 8L plus 1, 8L plus 2. So in clock cycle 8, 9, and 10, we are getting the sine extended version of the sine bit here. OK. So that's complete now. This whole part is complete. There's one more delay because of pipelining. Excuse me. So that delay, and then 2 to the power minus 1 followed by scalar. So that scalar, 2 to the power minus 1 scalar, has one delay here. So this starts in 8L plus 3. The result is available at 8L plus 3. Because of 2 to the power minus 1 scalar, we throw the LSB out. So this can begin in 8L plus 4. We haven't pipelined this, so the critical path continues. OK, well, so and then this one here. So if you think about this is connected to this switch. So first result is starting at 3. So it's available at 3. Now, when we get the first result, I am not going to use that result because that's thrown away. So this should connect from 4 5. So this result is available from clock cycle 3, 2. So the word is available 3 to 10. Okay, so that's 8 clock cycles. So the 8 bits serially are available in clock cycle 3 to 10. And this now is here from, so 3 is thrown out, 10 sine extends to 11, which is here. So that's 8L plus 3, so 11. And then this is 4 to 7 and 0 to 2. So 0 is the same as 8, 2 is same as 10. So that's really 8L 4 to 10, 4 to 10, but that's in time partition 0 to 2, and that's 3. Okay, so then the last, subtract, I guess. Okay, we need to subtract this x, so that's not an add. So to subtract x, so you have an inverter here, so that takes the 1's complement, and instead of having this 0, feed this to 1. Okay, so that's called subtract. So now I don't really need a programmable subtract, because in the programmable subtract, I could program that to be 7. This is constant coefficient. So just reset the carry to 1, so that subtracts. Inverted x and carry input 1 at LSB, that subtracts. Okay, so that's taken care of. And finally, we need to have that scalar, and that can be another switch. And so now if this starts 4 to 10, we throw out 5. So this will be 8L plus 5 to 12, 5 to 12. Let's keep it for now, 5 to 12. And in clock cycle, so this result is available in 4 to 11, 5 to 11. And then we sine extend in 12, so that's going to be 4, yeah. So this is 5 to 11. If you want to think about that, we can write that as 8L plus 0 to 3, followed by 5 to 7. So they are same things. And this is 8L plus 4. And that makes sense, because you will see that this was 3, this is 4, that makes sense. This is one number less than that. Okay, so then we are done with this whole thing is computing. If this is x, this is computing. This product here is minus 7 by 32x. Is that making sense? How the bit serial multiplier works? Or is it difficult to grasp? It probably is making sense, but you need to spend time working out some problems to fully grasp it, which won't happen, by the way. So, so let's go back to that digital filter. So now I need to compute 3 by 4 xn minus 2. Okay, how do I compute 3 by 4 xn minus 2? So, so 3 by 4 is simply half plus 1 by 4, which is 2 to power minus 1 plus 2 to power minus 2. And in Horner's expanded form, 2 to power minus 1 times 1 plus 2 to power minus 1. So if I take that is xn minus 2, for example, then I take the first switch. And then that's 2 to power minus 1. And then we add to that. So that's x plus 2 to the power minus 1x. And that result goes to another scalar. OK, that's kind of what it's on. OK, so there is also carry cleared to 0. If this x n minus 2 was available in clock cycle 0, then we would exactly do what we have done before, which is start this at, so these timings would exactly be same as here, 8L plus 1, okay, and then I didn't show, but this is 8L plus 2. Okay, so 1 less than that. Well, maybe not, maybe that, okay, that was, okay, before pipelining that was 8L plus 1, and after pipelining that changed to 8L plus 2. In any case, it's 1 less than the other one. Okay, so now we need to put these together. So now we take the previous part minus this quantity. So we take that circuit. So I take that circuit minus 7 by 32. Okay, let's go back to this circuit. Let's call this x n minus 1. And then I know the word length is 8. Okay, so the word length is 8. So I place 8 delays here. Why? Then that becomes x n minus 2. One word level delay is 8 bit level delays. So if I want to talk about this is x, this is un plus and this is xn. Xn followed by a delay is xn minus 1 times minus 7 by 32 followed by another delay times 3 quarter and we add these two, that result is added here. Okay, so that's why there are two loops here, the inner loop and the outer loop. So what I was trying to say, if the word length is 20 bits, what you see in this diagram here, we call this z to the power minus 1 or 1 word level delay or a sample delay in a bit serial circuit. If the word length is 20 bits, then we will have that corresponding to 20 flip-flops in the bit serial architecture. Okay, is that making sense? Remember that because we are feeding one bit at a time, it will take 20 clock cycles to feed the entire word. So if the clock speed of the bit serial design is at F or the clock period is at T, then the sample period is at 20 times T because 20 bits are input in 20 clock cycles, which is 20 times T, or the sample speed is F by 20 if F is the clock speed. So each time you see a delay in a so-called word-level block diagram, that should correspond to W delays in a bit-level diagram, which corresponds to a bit serial architecture. So these delays or these flip-flops have very different meanings, as you have been noticing in the class. If it is a two-parallel design, even in this kind of word-level circuits, if it is a two-parallel design, then each so-called flip-flop is not one sample delay, but two sample delays. Okay. If this was a two parallel design and you get to a bit serial design of that, then that each delay in the two parallel design would correspond to 16 sample delays. Well, it would correspond to 16 sample delays, but physically there will be 8 delays, physically. Very confusing, but that's kind of why you are in this class. Okay, so x n minus 1, this is one sample delay. This is equivalent to z to the power minus 1, which is 8 delays because word length is 8. Then I get x n minus 2. Then we take this part and put it here. So x n minus 2, so I have 1 delay here. There's a switch. add, and that goes to that. I'm not showing the carry circuit, and then there is another delay, another 2 to the power minus 1. Well, this. So that result then has to be added here. So we need to add this result. Oh, no, no. We need to add that result to input un. So we need to add that result to input un. Okay. So here is a trick. So remember that we have talked a lot about the iteration period bound, and we have seen what is the iteration period bound in this digital filter structure. That's the critical loop bound, which is the inner loop bound, which is 1 multiplied 2 adds. So the inner loop contains 1 multiply and 2 add operations. So the iteration period bound is 1 multiplied 2 adds. Now, when designers implement that and they want to reduce the critical path from 1 multiplied 2 adds, they don't actually implement that. What do you think they implement? The add operation un can be shifted to the part of the outer loop. It's a, after all, we are adding a few things. It doesn't matter in what order I add them. So if this is xn, this is xn minus 1, and then xn minus 2, and I can multiply this and this, and then add u here as part of the outer loop, and then add here, and then that becomes xn. So I'm applying the associativity of add operation. So now the inner loop has 1 multiply 1 add. So the critical path of the inner loop is 1 multiply 1 add. So t infinity is reduced from tm plus 2 ta goes down to tm plus ta. Because un is now part of outer loop. So outer loop is a non-critical loop because that had two delays. And that's why we can move non-critical operations, such as adding input, to the outer loop. Is that making sense? We haven't explicitly talked about this particular concept, but we have talked about associativity of add operations. So the un is added to... So these are small, small tricks, but ultimately these tricks add up to increase speed or power. I haven't really, well, we have talked about briefly how speed can be traded off for power by reducing supply voltage. We'll see. If we have more time, we'll talk about low power design. There is a whole chapter in the book, 17, I think. Okay, so you certainly can read that, but for now, so let's continue with completing this feedback filter. So we add that, and then I can add un to that. So we can add un, and there is some carry reset going on. And then finally, we add this here, another adder. And then finally, we feed that back to here. OK, so that's kind of. OK, let's take a pause to see what is going on here. There's a lot going on. I mean, that's kind of. So the un is now part of the outer loop. That's what I was trying to explain to you. Add un instead of adding 2n, adding un after these two products are added. First, add un to the product here, which is 3 quarter yn xn minus 2. OK, well, so now, in fact, we have to think about that there has to be some more delays here, so-called synchronizing delays. And if you think about what is exactly synchronizing delays, now the inner loop has one delay. So that means in the bit serial multiplier, the inner loop should have 8 delays. The outer loop has 2 delays, which means the outer loop in the bit serial should have 16 delays. So let's see how many delays are here. 3 here, 4, 5. So 5. So I should have 3 delays here. So that way, the whole inner loop now has 8 delays, which corresponds to one sample delay. By the way, I haven't pipelined all these. And these delays can be moved around to pipeline. If I chose to pipeline, I would put one delay here, one delay here and one delay here. So the three delays would be distributed, what is also same as retiming. Okay, now the outer loop. So how many delays are in the outer loop? So we have 3 and 8, that makes 11, 12, 13. So we need to have 3 more delays. So it doesn't matter where you place them. It does matter, okay, I should say it does matter, because if I put 3 delays here, and that's fine, but if I put it here, then you have to change this control signal switches by 3 cycles. So anyway, I think that all the ideas have come together in explaining to you what is going on here. So that's called a constant coefficient bit serial multiplier. Okay, this circuit in the book has gone one step further. Okay, let me try to explain to you what we have here. So this is where xn minus 2 begins, and that's a scalar plus, okay. So there is something else that I might explain. So for example, if you see these kinds of things, x with the 3 delays, and these 3 delays, it does not make sense to have 3 more delays. Just feed this one here, and then goes there. So there is already 3 delays here. I have a 3 delayed version of x, and I don't need that. So just feed this to the inputs, and that's what that's showing here. So that scalar, if you see that switch, that's 2 to the power minus 1, and it should be one more delay, but I just take that from here instead of taking another x from here and feeding one more delay. We can take that. That's this itself is a pipelining delay. That's a scalar. The reason u has been held for 3 cycles, because now it's delayed by 1 delay. You have to match these timings, because that's starting at 1, 8L plus 1. The result is available here at 1. After delay available at 2, because of the scalar, I throw the LSB away in 2 and start the actual add in clock cycle 3. And that's why this is 3, and that means U has to be held for 3 cycles. There is a lot of synchronizing concept going on. And certainly, I should say, companies like General Electric and many others, where when this book was, well, years before the book was written, there was a lot of interest in so-called bit serial silicon compilers. There was a lot of interest in silicon compilers those days, leading to high-level synthesis. That interest kind of faded, but believe it or not, high-level synthesis and silicon compiler now is a very, very hot thing. Why? Well, because of deep learning. Everybody wants to do high-level synthesis of deep learning. Okay, we'll get to that starting next week. Okay, so I just want to wrap up these things today. So we'll start talking about some machine learning in the last 3 weeks. Okay, so that starts at 3. And then these 4 delays are for synchronization purposes, as I was showing you here, placing 3 delays here. And then that's being added here. Now, strangely enough, you will see when you see this diagram, in a strange way, so here I had this whole circuit here. These 2 adders were here. We were adding minus 7 by 32. Which is in the serial form. So so this circuit is perfectly fine. What I've drawn here is perfectly fine. But I want to show you how I can reduce the latency. It's all about reducing latency or critical path. So if I want to, so because of the sequential nature, there is still some increase in latency. So what the diagram in the book shows is using some kind of add operation such that we can reduce the latency of this add operation. So think about this. So we are adding 3 things, A, B, C. So how, I'm not really sure if we can reduce latency or not, but I really am not sure, but let's Let's take a look. So if we are adding A, B, and C, so I have A plus B plus C. Okay.
Yeah, I don't see.
Okay, I guess. Yeah, we are. If you're adding three things, you can't really reduce latency very much. So the latency of what I have here is still two adders. So, well, definitely we didn't. This is showing here. This part here is, as you will recognize quickly, that this delay is a 2 to the power minus 1 scalar, the inverted, and a 1 here is subtract. So this is implementing minus 1 plus. Is this the same example? I assume it is. Oh, I see what mistake I did. I see. Yeah, I see what mistake I did. Okay, I've spent a lot of time and what I've shown is not wrong. Okay, this is not wrong. This is perfectly correct. But, what I have shown as a bit serial implementation is perfectly correct, but the representation is not 2's complement. This representation here is a non-standard representation and not 2's complement, because in 2's complement, this should be written as minus 1, the sign bit. So this minus 16 by 32 should be minus 1 plus 16 by 32, and then plus 8 by 32 plus 1 by 32. That's the bit 2's complement representation. And we can do that for fixed point, which is subtract minus half, which is take 1's complement at 1, and that's perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with that. That is not standard 2's complement representation. So I can see how, so we are adding four things. If we are adding four things, the latency would be 3. It so happens I didn't do that. And then one way to reduce latency is we add A plus B and C plus D, and then add these two, and that's kind of, so latency is reduced to from 3 to 2. So this is called a tree height reduction. We have talked about that before, and that's what the top one is doing, minus 1 plus a half. So that's 2 to the power minus 1 plus minus 1. So that's minus 1 plus half. In the bottom part here, that's computing out of these two terms, take 2 to the power minus 2 outside a bracket, 1 plus 2 to the power minus 3. So that's what these three delays are, 2 to the power minus 3 plus 1. And then there's a pipeline delay times 2 to the power minus 2. And then these two results are added. That's added to this whole thing here. And then if we just calculate the number of delays, so let's see, 1 plus 5, 6, plus 1, 7, plus 1, 8. So now I have three loops, which is OK, because I've broken down the one add operation to two loops, two add operations. So that inner loop has 8. That's correct. This, so if I take this loop, 3, 4, plus 2, 6, plus 1, 7, plus 1, 8. And that's still correct. That's still 1. So these two together are 8. That's that's essentially saying that instead of having minus 7 by 32, we are breaking that down to two multipliers, minus half. So multiply by minus half, and then another multiplier by 9 by 32. So this is two multipliers, and then added together. So, okay. So the outer loop should have two sample delays. So if we add, so you can see if I start here, so these are the 3 plus 5. That's what I was showing here, which is this 8 delays, because I've broken that down to this whole thing to two steps, so that 8 is a 3 plus 5 makes it 8. and then that's 2 to the power minus 1 scalar and continues. So 8 plus 1, 9, 10, 11, 15, 16. So that counts as 2
sampled alleles in the outer loop.
You have to count all these and make sure you place the right alleles. Very, very interesting. Very, very interesting. I should say that it was definitely as an exercise in designing architectures, bit serial architectures and bit serial silicon compilers. This was definitely very, very interesting. Okay, so the next part that I want to talk about is so-called canonic signed digit. And that's, so if we have fixed coefficients, so if these are fixed or constant coefficients, then we can implement numbers using canonic signed digit. Any idea what canonic signed digit is? Has anybody understood? Okay, that's fine. That's great. This is our place to learn. Okay. So what is a canonic signed digit? The word canonic, what does canonic mean? Something has been optimized. In this case, minimized. So that means the word canonic means I cannot represent that number using fewer 1 bits. So this is the lowest number, smallest number of non-zero bits. Okay. So let me take an example from the book again and see. Let's just take, this is 13.6.1. So let's take this number, 1.0111001. Okay. So what is that number in 2's complement? So that's equal to minus 1 plus 1 quarter, 1 eighth, 1 16th, 32, 64, 128, and 256. Okay. So so that is going to be, let's see, this whole thing here is 64 plus 32 plus 16 plus 2 plus 1, which is 96, 99, 115. So that's minus 256 plus 115 by 256. 6 minus 5, 1. 5 minus 1, 4. 2 minus 1, 1. Minus 141 by 256. Okay, that's that number. Okay, so how many non-zero bits here? Number of non-zero bits? Two, five, six. So the number of non-zero bits is 6. Okay, so how can we reduce the number of non-zero bits? So in canonic signed digit, just like I was already alluding to how I implemented that minus 7 by 32 is minus 16 by 32, although it was not a traditional 2's complement representation. Nevertheless, think about what I did here. So I represented that, so that number in 2's complement should be 1.111, that's a half, quarter, 0.8, 0.16th and 1/32nd. So that's 2's complement. What I did though is we represented that as 1 bar minus half, so that's 0.1 bar plus 1/4 and then 8th, 16th, and 32. Okay, I represented. So this quantity was 1 bar. Okay, so I should tell you that this is 2's complement, but this is not canonic sign digit. We'll see in a minute why this is not CSD. Not canonic sign digit. Okay. So in canonic sign digit, each unit can be 1 or 0 or minus 1, which we will call 1 bar. So 1 or 0 or minus 1. So 3 possible values. However, although 3 possible values, these are encoded using one wire. Okay. That's the key thing. Encoded using one wire. So to have 1 bar, which is minus 1, I just subtract, which is just take 1's complement and add a 1 at the LSB, exactly as we did before. Okay, so in CSD, each unit is a digit called as canonic sign digit. That's the name, is called a digit. It's not a bit. And the reason it's called a digit is because it takes 3 possible values. So 3 possible values are represented using CSD. Okay. All right. So so what's the very basic essence of CSD? So it's the same essence as modified booth recoding. The very basic idea, well, there is small difference. Okay, there's some difference. But the basic idea is the same. So the basic idea is if we have a string of ones, so let's say that I have 4 ones. If I have there is something going on, doesn't matter. So if I pick a group of 4 ones, okay, so let's say this is 0, this is 0, and some other things. Okay, so let's say that this particular weight is 1. I don't know what it is, but I mean, depending on these bits, but I can still assume relative to this, it's 1, 2, 4, 7, 8. 1, 2, 4, 8. Now, what's the sum of these 4 bits? 15. So that 15 can be written as what? Can be written as 16 minus 1. Okay, 16 minus 1. So it says that I can replace these 4 positions, continuous ones, by a 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 bar. So this is 16 and this is minus 1. So that's what CSD does. CSD replaces any time you see a continuous group of ones, it simply replaces those by 1 followed by zeros followed by 1 bar. Okay, that's CSD. There's nothing more to that. I mean, this at the end, all ideas are very simple. Okay, I mean, that's kind of after the fact, not before the fact. Okay, so because of that, so if it was 1, 1, what would that be replaced by? So if I, with respect to that, if I call it 1 and 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 3 would be written as 4 minus 1. 4 would be here. So that would be 1, 0, so that's 4, 2, 1, bar 0. So that this string is replaced by that string. 1 plus 2 is replaced by 4 minus 1. So one important property of CSD is there cannot be consecutive ones. There can never be 2 consecutive ones. If you see consecutive ones like this, that is not CSD. That's a property of the canonic sign digit representation. Although, if you just think about having the fewest number of non-zero bits, yes, it does have the fewest number of non-zero bits, but it does not satisfy the canonic sign digit property. Okay. So CSD does not allow consecutive non-zero bits, or
bits or digits. Okay.
Well, let's then, so with that, let's then go back to what I had here. So I had that number, 1.01110011. Okay, so that was that number, -141/256. So what is the canonic scientific principle says? If this is 1 plus 2, 3, so you first replace this by 1, 0, 1 bar. Okay, 4. This 0 stays. Now, what about these three? 1 plus 2 plus 4 is 7. Replace that by 8 minus 1. Okay, so we replaced 1 by minus 1. And this is 4 is replaced by 8. And now, what about here? What about here? What's the value of this number? Minus 1. Minus 1. Okay, and this number is plus a half. And then minus 1 plus half becomes minus half, so that becomes 0.1 bar. Is that making sense? So how many non-zero bits? Four. How many non-zero bits here? Six. So the number of non-zero bits can be reduced from 6 to 4. That means 6. So if it is a linear tree, then the latency of adding all these will be 5. Latency of adding all these will be 3. And if I take a binary tree, well, for 4 will be log 4 to base 2, which will be, latency will be 2. And the latency here in a tree, binary tree, will be log 6 to base 2. And the ceiling function of that would be 3. So the canonic signed digit representation can reduce the latency in fixed coefficient multipliers. So in those FFTs, when you saw those 0.707 or 1 by root 2, and you will see those are implemented as CSD, that means these are represented as few non-zero bits. I'm not sure how many, but that's kind of, let's see. Let's see what this really is. So if I take this as 0.5, and then 0.25, there's no 0.25, so 0.207, so I can represent that as 0.125, and then we have minus 0.125, that's 0.082, that's about 1/12, and then 1/16, 1/16 is 0.0625, 0.0625, so that's about 0.02. 0.02 would be somewhere between 32 to 64. So if I approximate that by, if I forget the remaining part, and if I approximate that, this 1, 1, so what exactly is this approximated value? This is half plus 1/8 plus 1/16. Okay, so that's 11 by 16. Okay, so that's about little less than 0.7, little less than 0.7. But if I convert that to canonic signed digit, so this 1, 1 becomes 1 bar 0, 0, and then 1, and these two together 1, so we have 1, 1, and that 1, 1 becomes 1 bar 0. One, I guess. Yeah, something like that. Well, I mean, I guess I'm not seeing a reduction in number of non-zero bits. But maybe if you take more, and then you can get some reduction. Okay, so so in general, if we have so in a W bit number, the expected number of non-zero bits in 2's complement is going to be what? take any arbitrary expected numbers, averaged over millions of numbers. So if we have W bit number, each bit can be 0 or 1 with probability half. So the expected value of A2's complement number, non-zero bits, will be W by 2 on average. If you take millions of numbers, count the number of non-zero bits, take the average, that's going to be half the word length. You can prove, which we are not going to do, but you can prove the expected number of non-zero bits in canonic signed digit is W by 3. So we can reduce the number of non-zero bits on average, averaged over many, many numbers, from half the word length to one-third of the word length. Okay, that's kind of, that's why canonic signed digit reduces the number of non-zero bits, and that's why we can reduce the number of adders and reduce the latency. So typical sub-expressions, I'm not talking about sub-expressions today, but typical patterns will be 0.101 bar, 0.101. So because there cannot be any consecutive ones, typically you will see in CST 1, 0 followed by either 1 or 1 bar, something like that. These are, so if you take a long word length of canonic signed digit, you will see these sitting at places. Okay, so that's kind of, because you can never have 1, 1. So that's kind of the so-called, and using that you can prove that it's going to be one-third of the word length, which I'm not going to prove, but the book. So the example that I showed, how to convert 2's complement numbers to canonic signed digit, but certainly the computer is not going to use my example. There is a computer algorithm to convert any arbitrary 2's complement number to a CST number as presented by Reitwiessner in reference 16. So let's take a look at that reference. That's 1966. So that paper that describes an algorithm to convert 2's complement number to canonic signed digit. It's published in 1966. Okay, so I'm going to stop here. So that's kind of a brief intro. I mean, brief intro to arithmetic, and there is a lot more. There is a whole chapter on so-called redundant arithmetic, which is something that we'll try to skip this year. And the chapter 15 on sub-expression sharing, which we might skip as well. I was alluding to that typical sub-expressions, but you can read them. Okay, so do come early. There is a big snow day on Thursday, so start early. Don't be confused thinking it will be nice spring day, so the bus may be late, so do come in time. And as I sent email, I have to leave an early afternoon, so come to my office if you have questions. Those of you who came late, I did say that I have posted one sample exam from last time, review the problem on data format conversion and systolic design, and the three sample exams from midterm one all have practice problems on folding and unfolding. So review those as well. And that's all about the sample exams. Okay, great. See you then next class. So don't go away, I have your graded exams, so please don't go away. And those of you who did not come last class, there are graded boomers. So those graded boomers are here also. Anu.